ಓಂ ಗಣಾನಾಂತ್ವಾ ಗಣಪತಿ ಗುಂ ಹವಾಮಹೇ ಕವಿಂ ಕವೀನಾಮುಪಮಶ್ರವಸ್ತಮಂ ಜ್ಯೇಷ್ಠರಾಜಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಣಾಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಣಸ್ಪತ ಆನಶೃಣ್ವನ್ ನೋತಿಭಿಃ ಸೀದಸಾದನಂ ಓಂ ಮಹಾಗಣಪತಯೇ ನಮಃ. ವಿಲ್ ಡು ದಿ ಓಪನಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ರೇಯರ್. ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ರಿಪೀಟ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಮೀ. ಓಂ ಸದಾ ಶಿವ ಸಮಾರಂಭಾಂ ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಮಧ್ಯಮಾಂ ಅಸ್ಮದಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಪರ್ಯಂತಾಂ ವಂದೇ ಗುರು ಪರಂಪರಾಂ. ಸೊ ದ ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಿಸ್ ಫೆಸ್ಟಿವಲ್, ದ ಥರ್ಡ್ ಒನ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಸೀರೀಸ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ ಟೈಟಲ್ ಈಸ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕವರಿಂಗ್ ಲವ್. ಸೊ ಐ ಎಮ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಗೆಟ್ ಯು ಆಲ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಅ ಕಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸಸೈಸಸ್. And that's why I suggested that you have some paper and pen with you. So has everybody managed to borrow steel paper? Even a small size would be okay, huh? Small one, like half of that. So if you need to tear and share, that's also fine. Okay. How many do not have paper yet? 2, 4, 5, okay. Okay, so we'll get started. I'm going to say an incomplete sentence, and I need you to fill it up with the first thought that comes to your mind. Okay? There are no right or wrong answers, obviously. I feel loved when dot dot dot. And please fill that up with the first thought or the first few series of thoughts that comes to your mind. I feel loved when dot dot dot. Complete it with the first thought that comes to your mind. If there are many ways in which you feel loved, then maybe you can write that as well. And the second part is, I express my love by dot dot dot, in whichever way you do. I express my love by dot dot dot. Fill that up with however you do express your love. Okay. So anyone willing to share something so personal? Yeah. How would you know when someone is thinking of you? They would like send you a text message? So you feel loved most when you hear words of love and appreciation. Okay? That's one of the ways. Okay, anyone other than this? You've written something, yes? So not only words of appreciation, but genuine, authentic words coming from a place of authenticity. Okay? What else? So practical actions, caring actions, because you probably will say, well, you know what? Talk is cheap. So show me you love me. Don't just tell me you love me. Yeah? So caring actions are very important for you. Okay? Okay, what about love from others towards you? No, so how do you feel loved when others do? How? So in the presence of a loved one, they may not talk to you, they may not do a particular caring action for you, but just in their presence, you feel loved. Is that what you're saying?
No, even in the absence. If I feel good about myself,
right,
I'll get a sense of optimism about things around me. Then I just think I
do. Okay, wonderful. Okay.
When the people I feel know me best seem genuinely pleased to see me.
Right. So that's the tricky one, you know, how to figure out this is really genuine. Okay. Okay. Last one, yeah?
Yeah, I feel like when I'm like fully present in who I genuinely believe myself to be and what everything is, and then it's all just a beautiful game.
When you bring these thoughts to your mind that it's all a beautiful game and Okay. So we've got an idea of how all of us feel loved in different ways, and we can actually classify that into five types. Okay. The first type is we feel loved most when we hear words of appreciation. And needless to say, they are genuine, okay? We are not going to fall for flattery. In fact, even if there is genuine appreciation, some of us are so skeptical that we don't even trust a genuine compliment, okay? So that's another story, we come to that. So words of appreciation is one. Second is caring actions from the loved person. And it would range from making a cup of tea to, you know, taking the person on a holiday, so on and so forth, doing a lot of things, making life comfortable for you. The third way in which some of us will feel most loved would be quality time. The person need not say a lot, do a lot, but you're just happy being in the presence of that person. The fourth way in which a lot of us will feel loved is when we receive gifts. Okay? So all through the year it's okay, but how dare you forget my birthday? It's not even about forgetting birthday. How dare you not wish me? How could you not be the first one to wish me? How could you not give me a gift? Or some such. The mutual funds, the banks will remember when your birthday is, right? Do you not get a message? You know, they're one of the first ones. I mean, obviously it's automated, but they're the first ones who will wish you. Or they will remind you your birthday is coming up. So please invest with us or whatever it is. And here there is no sign, no stirring in within the family that my birthday is coming up. They're not doing anything special for me. They don't really care, or they are so busy, or they have changed. Okay. And the last one where we feel most loved is touch. So some of us, you know, are very tactile. And the person may have said a lot of good things to us, may have given us gifts and spent quality time, but unless that hug is available, I don't feel loved. Can you see yourself within any of these or all of this? So one thing for us to understand is that given whatever is our background, the way we were brought up and our preferences, we feel most loved in certain ways. There's nothing right or wrong about it. That's my preferred way. But the problem arises when the other person doesn't get it, or actually we don't get it. So I want to only hear words of appreciation. I have a very sensitive ear, for example. So for me, the tone of that person, the person's voice, the tone in which the person speaks may be very important. But for that person, giving gifts is important, because that's how the person expresses his or her love best. And then I will say, because I'm not able to recognize that this is the person's preferred way of showing love to me, I will say, you don't love me. Eh? How did that happen? No, just look at how you talk to me. But honey, I'm giving you all these gifts and I spent a fortune for it. No, but you know, I don't like the way you talk to me. You don't love me. Fight. Misunderstanding. And then it will, of course, go to your families. I don't know if it happens. Probably it happens here in India. Definitely it happens. Your mother didn't bring you up right. Or maybe your father was like that, and that's why you're behaving in this way. Maybe you need to go for therapy or some such. Okay? And all because we didn't understand that that person's way of expressing love is different and it is okay. Because that is that person's way of expressing. So what did you all write in terms of how you express love? Is it the same as how you receive love? Is it the same for most of you? Yes? Anyone? Or is it different? Is it the same? Yeah, tell me. Yeah, so hugs are very important. You express love most by giving hugs, and you feel loved also when you receive a hug. Right? Is that right? Yeah? So it's likely to be the same. But like I said, the other person's way of relating might be different. And it's time that we open our eyes to this. A lot of our conflicts and misunderstandings would have been because of this. That we were not able to see that this is that person's way of expressing love. And it's okay. And so, I'm not saying you please reconcile with this. So you can, of course, tell the person how you feel loved the most. So that person includes that mode in their repertoire of engaging with you. And of course, you include the way in which that person feels really loved. It's very simple and straightforward. Okay? So now, when we're talking about this topic of love, we have a very sophisticated analysis of it in the Upanishad, in the Veda. You know that final section called Vedanta. And a lot of us will think that we love the other person because of his or her very good qualities and so on and so forth. But there is a very beautiful dialogue between a husband and wife talking about the nature of love. So here is the person whose name is Yajnavalkya. He is a rishi. He is a seer, a seer of mantras, extremely accomplished. And he has two wives. So he has been teaching the Veda and has built up a lot of wealth, and wealth includes cattle. And he comes to a certain phase in life and he says that I now want to leave for taking the robes. So this stage of life, which we call sannyasa, it's a stage and it's also a lifestyle. So he's not technically asking for a divorce, but in some ways he is. And here I'll just digress a little bit. The view of the human life is such that, this is according to the Vedic tradition, divided into four stages. So the first stage is where we are focused more on education and setting the right foundation for the rest of our lives. So it's also referred to as brahmacharya, which includes a lot of discipline. So going to a gurukula, studying, so on and so forth. Second stage is called grihastha, very, very important for the maturity of a person. So where you choose to have a partner, or you get married, you have children, or you adopt. And it's the most productive time of your life, because that's when you are contributing to society, you're contributing to each other, you are maturing out, you are learning to stay with the same person and fight, not leave. That's not easy. So this whole phase of grihastha, marriage, partnership, very important. Also the time when you actualize some of the education you have received. And then once the kids have grown and, as they say, flown the nest, then you're more in advisory role. So in the second stage, it was executive. You're all over, running around, getting things done, making your wealth, so on and so forth. And then you sort of take a back seat and move into advisory role. So you're no longer trying to control your children's lives. And then after that, because, you know, all the experiences of life have matured you so much and you have been prayerful all along, the last stage is where it was permitted to take to a life of renunciation. So for what? To pursue self-knowledge. So it was, renunciation was not what crazy people do. But it was considered as permissible that now you have lived a complete life and you're not actually renouncing, but things are dropping off you, in the sense you don't value a lot of the things as much as you used to earlier, and you want to devote all your time and effort for understanding yourself, God and the world. So Yajnavalkya, he approaches his wife, Maitreyi, and he tells her that I want to take sannyasa, meaning I want to take the robes. And one of the rules of sannyasa is if you're married, you have to take permission from your partner. You cannot just walk off. So what Buddha did, okay? So the wife didn't know. So technically, you're supposed to ask permission from your wife or your parents, whatever applies. And he tells her, I have divided the wealth such that you will have this, I've divided it between the two of you. So she asks a question, which implies that you are walking away from this wealth and you are giving this to me. This wealth that you give me, is it going to give me what you're going to get by walking off? And he was an authentic, honest husband, and he said no. He said no, it won't. And he says a particular phrase. He says that whatever is loved is really for the sake of the self. Atmanastu kamaya sarvam priyam bhavati. That when the husband is loved or the wife is loved, it's not for the sake of that person. It's because that person evokes the pleased self in you. In the presence of that person, or what that person does to you, because you're happy with that person, that's why you love the person. So what you really love is your own happiness. You cannot, do not want to be with someone who makes you miserable. And like that, he goes on explaining that even the children are loved not for their sake, but because they evoke the pleased person in you. So the children, and then he refers to the jati and the cattle and so on, like the almost 12, 16 things that he refers to. So this is something for us to unlock. That all, thankfully, all of us have had the experience of being loved. And when I say loved, I don't necessarily mean romantic love, okay? Love from our parents, from our siblings, friends, partners, of course, love from children, colleagues, so on and so forth. That when we are loved, we are happy, right? So you'll say this is a no-brainer. Yeah, of course we are happy. But it's not so simple. We are happy because the projecting mind, I want, I want, I want, I want, that is resolved temporarily. That this is going to give me happiness, when that's resolved under a certain condition, then I am okay. So there is a connection between the object of love and my happiness. That same person, when we become incompatible, or we have a fight, or you are exhausted, okay, or you are ill, the way you will relate to that person is going to be different. So we would want to command this condition all the time. Who doesn't want to feel loved all the time? But what does our reality suggest? That we, you know, it's shocking that the extent of depression that exists in this whole world. And there's 7 billion of us, right? I mean, it's ironical that we cannot find even a few people with whom we can be compatible and love and be loved. And everyone complains that they are not loved enough. Correct? that I only wish I was little more loved, or this person was a little more expressive, or something. Some complaint will be there. So, analyzing this experience of being loved, what happens is, there is complete acceptance. You feel accepted. And the other person doesn't seem to have an agenda for you. So you may be snoring, you may have very annoying habits, but still the person is accepting of you. And that vision of the person, that I am lovable, is what you really love. If that vision of that person towards you becomes your vision, then you can say what that gentleman was saying, which is that I feel loved when I am okay, right? But most of us are not like that, because that vision has not yet been transferred. In that person's eyes, I am lovable. And being loved makes me very happy. The two always go hand in hand. So when that person is not around, then obviously I am miserable. Then people will talk about being clingy and all. I'm sending feverishly text messages. Where are you? I haven't heard from you. What is happening? So on and so forth. All of this is happening. Why? Because I don't feel loved. That person's vision has not transferred to mine. So how can this vision transfer happen? Should it happen? Actually, it's the other way around. That if you are able to discover that in that experience of love, what has happened is the ego. Ego is a self-concept, okay? The ego is nothing more than that, your concept of self, which actually creates a sense of separation between you and the world. That ego resolves. When you are with a loved person, there is only love. Both egos have dissolved, which means what? The sense of separation that was there is no longer there. And that is when you are deeply happy. You get a glimpse of the wholeness. So this is W-H-O-L-E, okay? Of the wholeness that you really are. And that is what we love the most. And that is the nature of the Atma. Atma is not, it may be translated as soul, S-O-U-L, but we call Atma as Atma. Atma is you, it's yourself. So you get a glimpse of the Atma, wholeness, fullness, when there's no more projection, but the ego has resolved. There is resolution. And when you are okay with yourself, then you find yourself being very kind and loving to others. It's very natural. Like here, you know, I was commenting to someone, I can't remember who, that perhaps all of us, when we are traveling in the tube, our expressions and our eye contact with each other will obviously not be there. But here, everyone looks at each other, everyone acknowledges each other. Some people smile, some people give hugs, some people give free hugs also. Okay? So why? Because there is that ego which, you know, struggles with insecurity is not struggling so much in this given environment. Okay, so you're in harmony with the elements, and of course that's the theme. So you're in harmony with the elements, and when you are seeing greenery around you, You know, you see the lake, you see the trees. You are in harmony. And that is what happens to us when we have love. That when you are watching the lake, you may have a specific thing, or when will I go for a swim, you know, some practical things to work out. But you accept the lake for what it is. You may wish for better weather, perhaps, but you don't say, you know what, these clouds, how ugly they are. They have to be a little more beautiful. Or it should be a little deeper blue in the sky. You don't resist the sky. You don't resist the trees and the mountains and the stars. You're just able to appreciate their beauty. And you are in harmony with them. And a lot of us will say, oh, you know, I get fed up with London, if you work there, of course. And it's so busy, and the crowds and the pollution and so on. I love nature. Actually, you don't love nature. You love the pleased self that gets evoked when you are in nature. Because it also happens that suppose you are missing your dear one. Suppose you've gone for, let's say you've come here. And you really wish that some people you are very fond of had come here. Then you will just keep missing them a lot. You see, I really wish they had benefited from this. You're not quite here. But when you're watching something like that, and especially for all of us, when we are with trees, with the waters, mountains, and I have not met anyone yet who says, I don't like nature. So anyone who is in nature experiences that. Because that ego, you know, which creates a sense of separation, just dissolves. So I have no agenda for the mountains and the rivers to be different. I don't have a projection on them. I see them for what they are, objectively. And I enjoy it. I am in harmony with it. And the times that we have experienced love, all kinds of love, unfortunately, it becomes incidental, you know, it's based on certain incidents, is when I am in harmony with the other. The other could be very annoying, but still I am in harmony with that person. And in a moment of understanding, I don't have a sense of separation with that person. There is an experience of oneness. And that oneness, which is pointed out in the Upanishad, is stated to be Atma Vare Shrotavyaha. That this Atma that manifests as wholeness and the most dynamic form of wholeness or fullness is love. Because there is no sense of separation. There is only an understanding and an experience of oneness. Then how are you going to relate to everyone? Because everyone is like you. Everyone is an extension of you. Everyone is really not everyone. You strike off the every. All that is here is one. So it's like how the different parts of the human body, it's one being. But the liver has a different function, and kidney and heart and lung and so on and so forth. They are all relating to each other. They are all coexisting with each other. They are different from each other, but they are in harmony with each other. So this love that we seek for outside is to be discovered by us in the form of what is our nature, what is our swarupa, what is it that defines me? And that happens to be the infinite. And that infinite, when understood, it expresses itself as love. That love may be kindness, depending on situation, it could be compassion, it could be tough love, it could be discipline. that you do what is required in that given situation because you don't have an agenda to manipulate, to control. But generally what happens is, you say, I love you, therefore sit down. I love you, therefore you should not talk to that person. Correct? So love actually becomes control. And we'll try and do cosmetic changes with our language. Okay? But it is that same love, when distorted, becomes anger, becomes hatred. Because our own nature is not understood, what happens is, when that object of love does not listen to me or does something that I don't like, I am seething with anger. And then I say, oh, I have to control my anger. But you wouldn't be angry with a stranger on the street. You wouldn't care less. Why are you so angry only with this person? Because you have a lot of love for this person. That same love, distorted, is experienced as jealousy. Because then what creeps in is my need to be special and my need to control. So we're all control freaks, okay? Only the degree varies and our masking varies. But everyone wants to control, especially the person you love. Why? Because that person is a source of happiness for you. So that object of love evokes the pleased self, makes me happy, and my happiness is like a yo-yo. So according to certain conditions, conducive conditions, I feel happy and therefore loved. When this person behaves in a very bad way, or not according to what I want, and remember, I'm a very moody person, then I don't feel loved, I don't feel happy, I'm fighting all the time, or I'm sulking all the time. I either withdraw or I go on the attack. So, recognizing this pattern and understanding that, really speaking, the love that I have for the other, which I claim to have, is really love for myself. So is this being selfish? It's not. It's the truth. It's because you have love for yourself that a person may commit suicide. Because I love myself so deeply, they may not articulate it that way. And nothing around me gives me happiness. So it's better for me to go away than to continue living. Even the one who claims to be a martyr, oh, you know, I don't have any existence, or all that matters is you, I am happy to be a doormat, so on and so forth. That person has a certain image of himself or herself and wants attention, wants love, and that is the pattern that the person has learnt. So, I have another exercise for you. And this is where your pen and paper will come into the picture. For this exercise, okay, I'll tell you all that later. You have to write at least 5 to 7 statements in legible handwriting, because it will be read by another person, that's why I'm saying. All the things that you have received as a compliment, whatever comes to mind, okay? Before that, may I ask, how many of you pray or relate to God of your understanding? How many of you? So that's, I can't quite figure out okay, so some, okay, so like 30%, maybe 30-40, okay. Okay, so what we're going to do now, and I play some music as well, that's why I kept my phone here. So what we're going to write are a bunch of compliments that we have received, and any statements of love, endearment, whatever it is that we want to hear. Okay? I may have heard it from people around me. I may not have heard it. But what I yearn to hear about myself, pointing to the fact that I am deeply lovable. So it will read something like, I love you very deeply, you are da da da, whatever, something something, so on and so forth. So just feel free to write whatever comes to you, and I'll tell you what to do next. Okay, so thank you for doing that. Now I'm going to ask you to find someone with whom you can sit. Anyone. Okay? So find a partner for now, temporary partner. Okay, not like a partner. Okay. So now, what are you going to do? So I'm hoping that your handwriting was legible. So what needs to be done? So let's just check. Kerry and Angelina, yeah? So Kerry has written something. I'm just suggesting sort of a demonstration, and then that's what all of you are going to do with your respective partners, okay? So Angelina is going to close her eyes. Before that, what you will do is you will tell Kerry whether you want to be stroked on the head or on the shoulder, or you want your hand to be held. So what's your preference, either of the three? Okay. And what Kerry is going to do, so Angelina is going to close her eyes. Everyone can see them, sort of, or at least get an idea. So she's going to close her eyes, and Kerry is going to, stroke her shoulder and read what Angelina is already going red. Angelina has written. Got it? Okay? So, but don't add anything. You faithfully read what the other has written. And of course, you will do it in a very kind and loving voice. Yes? So you do that until you finish. And once you finish, then you can do it for her. Is that okay? Everyone got it? So you can start. So check with what touch is comfortable and just faithfully read what's there. So please don't use this time for any discussion. Okay, everyone's had a chance. How many need more time? Okay. So we'll just wait for them to finish. Done? Okay. So the rest of it will be homework maybe. Okay. Okay. So let me hear some observations from you. Anyone who is willing to share? Yes?
My observations, we were very different in this. So this lady had very internal qualities to be appreciated. Mine all tended to be things about things I'd done. And when I looked back to look at everything earlier of how I expressed my love, it was very much I expressed my love through doing various things. Yoga and things like that. And so when it came to looking at the list of my things, I sort of felt that, well, they're not really about me, they're about stuff I've done and they're sort of transactional. And it was very much my list.
So when she read out the things that you wanted to hear, how did that make you feel?
They were out of context.
Okay.
Because they were all very contextual things, and that she hadn't had the experience of the actions I'd been doing to appreciate. And
so you wanted a more personal touch, because you know the context, and that's why you wrote what you wrote.
That's it, but it's through the, I think it's through the appreciation of the action as I'm carrying it out. And it's this, when you remarked earlier that how do you know it's genuine, when I said that, it's you can feel that appreciation of the things you do in the warmth and reaction.
Right. May I ask her, when he read out the things that you had written and what you wanted to hear, what was your experience like? Fine. We're not comparing, because you know I'm just really focused on what is your experience of hearing what you want to hear. Okay, good, very nice. Anyone else? Yes. Yes. Wonderful. And what was your experience like?
I think the same. Although I did feel a little bit like what I've written was always a good cover of my own ego. It was things I needed to make me feel good about myself. And actually, that's what happened. When I heard them, it did make me feel good.
Yeah. Yes? Wonderful. Tears are good. Okay. So just like mucus is good, tears are good.
So I just felt, and I wrote loads for me, so then I felt like I was bigging myself up, and I was like, oh, I don't know, so it felt a bit disparate, because I know her so well, I know she could have written loads of things, and I don't know, it felt a bit weird to then receive mine back.
Yeah. Okay, so yeah, a few others, yes. So you've read out for her and also done a loving action, yeah? Okay. Which was not a part of the agenda, but you know, you reached out and that's wonderful. Yes.
Swamiji, another question.
Yes. Yeah, see, whatever we hear, we will feel it somewhere in the body. There are always accompanying sensations. The likelihood is you will feel it in the heart. Yeah, that's how it is. That's how we are all connected. So, you know, reflecting on this exercise, the truth is that each of us is lovable. But we are not able to receive love. We're not able to fully see our own fullness. A lot of the times we reject the love we receive. For whatever reason, okay? And we think wrongly that because a person loves me, therefore I am lovable. You have to flip the equation. It's not like that. You are lovable and that's why someone loves you. And that love is actually not a verb. This is your nature. Love is your nature. When limitlessness, that is the nature of the Atma, that is you, it manifests in this dynamic medium of this human birth. It is very natural to be loving and to be loved. What is most natural for us is to be loving. Very natural. To be kind, to not harm someone, and to be in harmony with everyone. This is our natural self. This is what the Upanishad points out. It is what we will call Lakshana Vakya. It's pointing out to something that love and that evoked, pleased self is really fullness. And that fullness is my nature, ananta, limitlessness. That is not understood by me. Why? Because I have ignorance, avidya. I think I'm limited. I think I'm not worthy. So this whole issue of self-esteem, that I have a critic sitting always by my side, who's always pointing out the wrong things I've done. Okay? Even if someone is very genuine with me, I cannot accept it. I'm always doubting because I'm so afraid to trust. All of us have struggled with trust issues. But as babies, we were blessed with the ability to trust. So when someone, you know, maybe your parent or caregiver at the age of two, suppose that person threw you up in the air and lifted you, you know, threw you up and then held you. You didn't have trust issues then, okay? Otherwise, you would have had a heart attack right there. You see, is this person going to hold me? By God, I will just crash to the ground and that's it. That's the end of me. Nothing. Because there was no language. But there was no sense of distrust. That along with helplessness, extreme helplessness, came a sense of complete trust and surrender. That whoever, I don't know, they're all dysfunctional maybe in my family. But I trust. I surrender. I have no other choice. I just surrender. And it is this surrender, this dissolving of ego. Ego is just a boundary, okay? It's an artificial boundary. It's not absolutely real. It is when that dissolves that we are able to see ourselves as love. So the vision of Vedanta is to see that this is who you really are. And that's why we simulated an exercise whereby you are able to get a glimpse of how deeply lovable you really are. So depending on how you approach the exercise, or you wish that, oh, you know, this person, I would have liked to hear it from someone else, but this just happened to be a stranger. However it worked out, the point is that we can be in charge of being loving. We cannot be fully in charge of the love that we receive. Okay? So you are free to love. But there are two things that stop us. One is what we call raga. So my craving, my need to control. I want X and Y to behave in this way. So I will be loving to that person only when this person listens to me. I was doing a workshop with parents and then I asked the mothers, so when do you feel loved? And this mother said, when my children listen to me. And I said, you've added, you will never feel loved. So she was expecting obedience from her children, and mind you, children are teenagers, okay? So she is sinking into depression. Why? Because she doesn't feel loved. Why? Because she wants to control and children are not listening to her. So what I'm saying is that having relative love in our lives is not dependent on other people showing love to us. It is dependent on me showing love to others. And only when I have relative love in my life, am I ready to take the step to seeing that I am that absolute love. So that requires a process of study of Vedanta, a certain process of preparation, being exposed to the scriptures, studying certain texts systematically. But before that, I need to have relative love in my life. And the only way to be loving, you know, I tell you the secret. The only way to be loving is, can you make a guess? The only way to be loving is to love. That's it. That's the secret. The only way to be loving is to be loving. You don't have to look for a golden opportunity, or as an Indian would say, for the right muhurta, right time. I will do astrological calculation, then I will be loving. No. Or I will eat some organic food and then I will be loving. No. Or I will do after my yoga practice, I will be loving. No. So the more and more I am able to see that what is here is intelligence. People are the way they are because of their background. I'm not interested in labeling and jumping to categorizing them. They are there in my life for a reason. And I am related to five sets of factors. And this is where I am able to practice my love. Don't think that you want to only limit your love to your romantic partner or to your dog. Okay? Don't let only that person or being be an object of your love. You know, you're holding back for I don't know what reason. You are connected to all people around you. And exactly like how here at the yoga festival, it's very natural for you to smile at each other. Same people, same you in the tube. You don't want to make eye contact with anyone. Same people, okay? So it's coming very naturally to you because you feel you're committed to a similar purpose, you're connected to each other. So I'm saying just with your family members. Family members, friends, office colleagues, okay? That's our little world. How can I do more kind and caring actions for them? Because we have to discover love. That is our nature. Discovering love is not looking at Tinder and swiping left and right, okay? Because unfortunately, we associate the purpose of our life is to get love. A lot of people say, like a beggar, I want some crumbs of affection. So anybody who is little loving to me, okay. Why? Because I want to feel loved. But the point is you are lovable. You are a manifestation of Ishvara. You're extraordinary. You are the limitless that you are actually seeking. And so you are connected to all people around you. In your little world, this is what we call Manushya Yajna. That it doesn't matter what the other person is doing, not doing. Your nature is to love and you do that. You do caring actions for the other. You don't have to look for some esoteric, mystical reason to be loving for another person. Then you are also connected to all plants, animals and nature. All this stuff about environmental sustainability we talk about because we have treated things as objects around us. They exist for my consumption. It's a very wrong way of thinking. That I am connected, the air that I exhale is the air that the tree inhales. And so I live a life of least injury. Because life feeds life. There's no way that you will not, you know, injure something. So even, you know, you use your floor cleaners. You're killing bacteria, viruses, but it's required. Otherwise, you will not survive. So there is some level of violence that is there in our lives. Okay? Causing little injury, some hurt, killing beings. We're walking on the grass. There are insects that might be trampled. But the sensitivity that is there in each and every one of us, that I am loving towards plants, animals, use of resources, so on and so forth. It's a connection I have, and it's a connection that I must honor. The third is my relationship with my teachers, whoever the teachers are. Here we generally say it is the Veda, the Rishis. But anyone you consider a teacher, because pretty much all learning that we have had, even if it's online learning, it's because of conscious beings that were there in that body of knowledge. And so you acknowledge and you do something that is an act of care, either for them or to keep that tradition going or to share that knowledge. The fourth group of people we are connected to are our ancestors, our parents. Some of our parents may have been dysfunctional. Maybe all of them have been, I don't know. Okay? But the point is that they did what they did that they didn't really want to harm us, but they didn't know any better. And the love that they had for us may have been twisted or may not have been twisted. But the point is that they were the instruments for us to be here and to have a wonderful life. And so we acknowledge and do acts of care for our parents, or there are rituals, I'm sure in every culture, definitely in India we have, for the dead and gone. We have these annual rituals that are done, sometimes also done every month. And then the fifth group of people, beings that we are related to, are what we will refer to as devatas, deities. Deities are like heads of department. So for water bodies, we will say Varuna. So you may or may not connect with this, but you can connect with the fact that for every phenomenon or every process, even within the company or a project, there is someone who is in charge. And so all these phenomena that we are experiencing on a day-to-day basis, moment-to-moment basis, is because there are different beings working. You know, for this festival, there are at least 100 volunteers on site. They're making things possible for us. So what shall we say about this entire world? It's not random, of course. There are beings that are working for certain processes, and so we do acts of care and we show our love towards them. So then what happens is, there is a lot of love in my life because I am always engaged in acts of care, warmth, love for all these factors. Not only to my romantic partner, definitely to a romantic partner, but also to my children. So my children are not people to whom I only just exchange a checklist. Did you eat? Did you do your homework? Who did you meet? It's not a court martial. It's not an interrogation. I can share how my day was like. But generally, we allow this care to fly out of the window in the whole process of the checklist, you know. So, the only way to love is to love. And we are in charge of that. No one can say, I am helpless. I don't know how to love. You already said, you know, the way in which you express love, you have already listed. So, you know that. You also know that others will express their love in different ways. So now you have a certain sensitivity and you can resonate with the other with respect to how that person expresses his or her love towards you. And you are also able to see that you are deep intelligence and you are pervaded by Ishvara. That you are just an absolutely perfect manifestation. That all the laws, all the principles have conspired to make you the way you are. And that makes you deeply lovable. Whether X or Y loves you or doesn't love you, that's not the point. Although we become obsessed about it. The point is that you are lovable. And by the way, X or Y or Z may or may not love you, may or may not show love to you. But you can show love and care to all of these five. You can show love to Manushyas, the people. This is what we call Manushya Yajna. You know, my acts, my karma, this is to be done actually. Not to be done, not as a burden. But it is an acknowledgement of my sense of interconnectedness with these five factors. So people, manushyaha, then bhuta, different beings, plants and animals, definitely your dog or your pet. Then pitras, my ancestors, I am deeply connected to. Fourth are rishis, teachers, that I have received a lot of learning from. And the fifth are devatas. So even when you do the sun salutations, you are acknowledging Surya Devata. So can you see, we are so deeply interconnected to all these five factors. And when I say five factors, I am talking about five sets of beings that have contributed and continue to contribute to our lives. So the question is, how can I show my love, my care for these beings on a day-to-day basis? And you will find that you will have lot of love in your life because you have now discovered love in your life. It's no more a verb that you do to your cat or dog. You have discovered that you are that love. That the love that you were seeking as a projection outside, where that love was inhibited by cravings, aversions, raga, dvesha, no more is inhibited. So this is, when I say love is your nature, I'm not saying this la la land kind of, because some people say, you know what, love to be needs to be strong. Well, however you want to express it, it's up to you. But all I'm saying is, because you are love, therefore you are lovable, and therefore you can be loving, and you can also receive. You're not going to distrust everyone who pays you a genuine compliment. No, but I don't think you're genuine, but I don't think you're authentic. Well, the person is saying, genuinely means it. It means that I don't have the ability to trust. That what is the great indicator of authenticity that I am looking for? I'm looking for certainty. Perhaps I'm looking for the infallible, which is God. But I am seeking it in beings that are fallible, that are capable of making a mistake. And that is not acceptable to me. So here is where I need to understand that my search for the infallible will only end when I discover Bhagwan or Ishvara. That if I'm expecting a person around me to be perfect without mistakes, I'll have to be born and reborn again and again. There is no such person, no such guru either. Okay, every guru, every person, being a human, definitely has limitations. But the point is, the truth of who we are is pure being. And that pure being, when it manifests in a dynamic, interactive way, is love. When that love gets distorted, then of course anger and jealousy and so on and so forth. So the way to discover relative love in our lives is to be loving. No excuses. When I throw it up for questions, there will be some excuses. But you know that person or that one doesn't do this for me, then why should I be loving? We'll come to that. Okay? So relative love we have to discover in our lives by being loving. And I've said we relate to all these five factors. Then we are ready to discover the absolute love that we really are. Right now you might just take what I say at face value. But you may see the logic of what I am saying. And when you try it, or the moments you have tried it in your life, you see the truth of what I am saying. You know it to be true. So like everyone is very affable and smiling at everyone in the yoga festival. So not, and it's alcohol free, as far as I know, unless somebody has smuggled in anything. But from what I understand, it's alcohol free. So if we are able to do that without being on an artificial high, all we have done is invoked the loving person that we really are. The simple, kind, loving person. And that is very natural, because you don't complain that, you know what, I am so loving, I hate it. No one says this, right? Because you're absolutely at ease with yourself. So even if you love your work, you actually don't love your work. You love the pleased self that it evokes. And that work may involve admin work, or it may involve conceptualizing a project, or it may involve teaching yoga. Whatever that work is just a medium for your own fullness, wholeness to manifest. Because what we deeply seek, what we yearn for is fullness. And that fullness has to be discovered as your nature. Only then the search will end. Until then, we will keep searching and keep searching and keep searching it out there until, you know, we get exposed to Vedanta. So I'm ready to take questions now.
We really enjoyed that, but we noticed that no one gave you any, so we come at five. Super slobby-licious, you rock the colour orange, you have a really smooth, silky voice, your classes are full of soul and love.
And we love you.
And we love you.
Oh, I love you too. Thank you. Thank you. Can I ask, what is the relation with that person?
Romantic partner.
See, if the person is cruel to you, okay, and is abusive, there's no reason why you need to be together. Okay? It's possible that the person is being cruel because the person wants to punish you. And so, it would be better to enter therapy, couple therapy, because we seem to have lost a way to communicate to each other. Because generally what happens is, there's a lot of love initially, but a lot of it is also projection. I have a certain image, that person happens to fit the image at that time. Then of course I wake up to reality, that person is nothing like what that person was in the image. And then I cannot relate to that. So if both people learn to accept each other, see that you are different, I am different, and we will learn to be in harmony. You don't have to be like me, I don't have to be like you. Okay, that calls for a tremendous amount of maturity. And if a third person helps us to communicate better, then things might work. But if the person continues to be abusive or whatever, maybe that person needs to go for therapy. Maybe there are some childhood issues because of which that person has developed a pattern like this. But I'm assuming that you would have taken a lot of effort to try and resolve it and it's not resolving. And so that's why I'm suggesting therapy. If it was initial stages, I would have suggested that it can be sorted out through communication. Through telling the person what you want and what is acceptable to you. Because one thing we must understand is that while in the experience of love there is dissolving of boundaries, sometimes that person cannot respect the boundaries that also need to be there. Okay, it's not collapsing of all boundaries. There are some boundaries that must be maintained. And therefore, if that person is always, you know, crossing the boundary of what is acceptable and what is not acceptable, then either the person is pushing you too much to see, you know, testing you all the time. Do you really love me? I push you more. We all have this tendency. We do it in different ways. I push you. And then there is a big explosion. So maybe the person is going through all this, but I think therapy is possibly a way out. Yeah.
What if it's beyond, what if therapy doesn't work and you have to go your separate ways? Do you still love that person?
You can continue to have love for that person. Love does not necessarily mean that you have to be together. Okay? It sounds ironical, but you know, love doesn't get you to live in peace if you're not compatible. So if you can't even communicate, you know, you can have a cordial conversation with your office colleague, but you can't even have a cordial conversation with your partner. And all attempts to resolve compatibility have not worked. Then it really means that that person was in your life for a particular reason. you thank that person mentally or in person, see the lessons that you can derive from it. Perhaps it has matured you out. Perhaps you have also realized the kind of projections you had, and maybe it's time to, you know, be objective to reality. And be grateful for the fact that you had that experience of love, that it helped you to discover that you are lovable. It's a shame that it didn't work out, the relationship. But there is love in your life, you are lovable, and you wish well for that other person. And of course it's sad, and you will have to go through a bit of a grieving process. Okay, but as a lot of people here who have survived more than one relationship can definitely tell you that things will be well with you. Okay, I wish you well. Yes.
You mentioned the mom with the teenage children. I have children, you can tell her, who are in their 20s. The problems still continue, and it doesn't get better. More and more there is a demand nowadays for unconditional. You mentioned the five elements, one of which is parents and grandparents and ancestors. How do you balance that duty with the demands of children and society now for unconditional love?
Unconditional love is actually not possible. It's not possible. What they are seeking is love for God, because they are seeking love at all times, in all places, in all situations. That's not possible from a human being. Okay? No matter how brilliant the person is and how saintly the person is, it's not possible. Because of course even the saintly person will need to sleep. Okay? It's not available. So it's a myth that unconditional love is possible. The parent-child love is as conditional as it can get, and it's very beautiful. So, when anybody talks like that, you actually ask them, what are the conditions, or what is it that I can do for you? How would you like to feel loved? What would make you feel loved? Because they are actually complaining that they don't feel loved. That's why they say, oh, but you should love me unconditionally. So how would you like to feel loved? It's a very simple question, but it's a question none of us ask, because we are embarrassed to ask. Or we're saying, but if I ask, then it's going to be very awkward. So let's not, you know, preempt all these things. Just ask. And be there for that person. It's so simple and straightforward. Because you're happy to love them in the way that they would like to be loved. Yeah. The more you discover your relationship with God, that is what will seal it for you. You will always be loving towards everyone. Because you see the order, you see the principles, you see the laws operating, and you see that all that is here is Ishvara. But it's something to be discovered over a period of time. And we have to retrieve this understanding and our need for the infallible from the many ideas we have about God. But you know, this Alcoholics Anonymous works brilliantly, because the first step is where you say, I surrender to the God of my understanding, whatever is your understanding. But you know, you have to come to that step. Okay, any more questions? Yes?
I have a teenage daughter, and sometimes, you know, she just shouts back at you. Or how do you deal with that when a child is just being, sometimes just rude, or not knowingly, just...
Yeah, there are two ways, okay? So, if your teenage daughter is shouting back at you, one, don't take it personally, okay? She's just venting. And the second is to also tell her that, you know, when you shout like this, it really hurts me. I don't want to be hurt. So please keep it down. Generally what happens is, we don't know how to request. Our request is presented as a demand. Stop shouting. Or don't you dare talk to your mom like this. What I'm really saying is, I don't want to be spoken to like this. it hurts me, it upsets me. So please don't do this. But we actually shout back. Okay, so these are the two simple ways. Anything else? Any other question? Yes?
Does love have to be expressed in words, or is it just self-indulgent, so it should shine by itself?
Love, Ananta, your nature is self-effulgent. It anyway shines by itself. But there is a veil of avidya. And so to pierce through that avidya, there is also adhyasa, projection. So to relate to each other, it is better to express love. Because despite all our communication workshops and everything, lot of us, most of us do not feel understood. It's unfortunate. But we don't. So it's better to tread on the side of caution and express. Okay, I think that's, yeah?
When I say to my son, don't speak to me like that, he said, well, you should be able to deal with it, all the therapy you do.
Yeah. So tell him what you're feeling and request him for something. What are you actually feeling when he talks like this?
Very upset.
So say that to him. But the way you say it, you know, your tone and everything, it sounded like a demand. Don't talk to me like that.
Yeah?
It's a demand. When you're demanding of anyone, they are not going to accede. They are not going to meet your demands. We are all rebellious, okay? So he's not going to meet your demand. So you can request. Does it mean, is there a guarantee that everyone is going to listen and totally respond to your request? No. But there's a good chance. Because obviously your son cares for you. And so if you say that, oh, this really upsets her, then maybe he will try to not be rude. So try that and see. It's very simple, you know. Yeah, this is a very good question. When do you express? Well, you express most of the time, okay? And this is where we think about the army. You know, the army or any defense forces, when do they prepare for war? Is it when they see some signs of tension? They are always preparing. They are always battle ready. Okay, so if there is war, if there is a fight, they can deal with it. If there's no fight, well, they keep preparing. It's the same thing with the immunity of the body. Am I going to start preparing for the immunity when infection is going to strike or infection has struck? No. I ensure that my communication with my loved ones is good enough. I'm expressing what I need to. I'm also able to listen and receive what they are saying. Not easy. It requires effort. And so when a conflict arises, then it also diffuses quite quickly. Because that person already understands me. I understand that person. And you say, okay, well, you know, it was just venting or I just lost my cool or some such. You will always give the other person benefit of doubt. But if you've not had that communication channel open and suddenly you have a great fight, then sometimes these fights, they lead to divorces. They lead to like complete breakdown. So the time to resolve is not when you have a fight or when there is infection. You are always preparing. You're always communicating. You're always expressing your act of care and love for the other person. Yeah? Okay? That's fine. Okay, I think we've exhausted questions for now. If anyone wants to connect with me, my website is discoveratma.com. So that's discover and then atma.com. I also have a podcast called The River of Wisdom. And my email ID is there on the website. So if you want, I can give it to you, or you can get it from the website. Either way, thank you. Thank you all. I've really had a good time and really enjoyed myself. I wish you well, and I will end with a prayer, which means that may there be happiness for everyone. May everyone be free from sorrow, and may everyone be free of disease as well. Om sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kaschid duk abhag bhavet. Om shanti shanti shantihi. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.